All right, let's stand together. Sometimes I'm reminded at just how much of an idiot my brother-in-law is. He just stepped up behind me as I'm trying to play the piano, and he begins to play Froggy Went A-Courtin' on his guitar in my ear, as if I don't have enough issues already. All right, what are we going to sing, Brother Luke? Redeemed. Let's sing it together. Page 348. It's good to see you this evening. 348 in your hymn book. Let's sing it out good and loud. I'm excited to hear from our kids this evening. They're going to sing. We've got a kids choir, and I'm looking forward to hearing from them in just a little bit. Before then, though, let's sing a couple songs together.
Redeemed, now I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through His infinite mercy. His child and forever I am. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child and forever I am. Redeemed and so happy in Jesus, no language my rapture can tell. I know that the light of His presence with me doth continually dwell. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child and forever I am. I think of my blessed Redeemer, I think of Him all the day long. I sing, for I cannot be silent. His love is the theme of my song. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child and forever I am. I know I shall see in His beauty the King in whose law I delight. Lovingly guardeth my footsteps and giveth me songs in the night. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child and forever I am.
All right, let's sing Send the Light, page 656 in your hymnal. Send the light.
There's a call comes ringing on the restless waves. Send the light, send the light. There are souls to rescue, there are souls to save. Send the light, send the light. Send the light, the blessed gospel light, let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light, the blessed gospel light, let it shine forevermore. We have heard the Macedonian call today. Send the light, send the light. And the golden offering at the cross we lay. Send the light, send the light. Send the light, the blessed gospel light. Let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light, the blessed gospel light. Let it shine forevermore. Let us pray that grace may everywhere abound. Send the light, send the light. And the Christ-like spirit everywhere be found. Send the light, send the light. Send the light, the blessed gospel light. Let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light, the blessed gospel light. Let it shine forevermore. Let us not grow weary in the work of love. Send the light, send the light. Let us gather jewels for a crown above. Send the light, send the light. Send the light, the blessed gospel light. Let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light, the blessed gospel light, let it shine forevermore.
All right, we're going to have a word of prayer, and then Brian, I think I'd like to have your family sing just when we're done praying, so if you guys want to get ready. And then all you kids that are packed on this front row, I'm going to have y'all sing during the offering. All right, so you're going to have to sit here for a few minutes. You're doing very, very well so far, and so keep doing that. The longer I have you sit here, the more nervous all of their parents get. And we already have one that's busting some dance moves down here during the hymns and getting a little rowdy. Let's see how this goes. I'm excited to have these kids sing tonight. All right, so when we sit down in a minute, kids, you might have to spread out a little bit. And I was told a funny story a minute ago. Somebody, my daughter Mariah and son Levi up here on the front pew, someone thought that they were a missionary couple and these were their kids. What does that say about missionaries? But all right, anyway, I guess they have like three sets of quadruplets or something. I don't know. All right, let's have a word of prayer. Before we do, I told you I'd tell you tonight, the Faith Missions cards aren't out anymore, and so we're going to kind of call it off right where it is right now. If you want to give, obviously, there's still ways for you to give. As of right now, somebody wasn't right with God because we are $429 shy of hitting $180,000 for the year. So just saying, pray about it and do what you need to do. But right now it sits at $179,471, I think is what it is. So $529 short, I guess it is. But anyway, that's a huge increase from last year. I am excited, very excited to see what the Lord does through Faith Missions giving at this church this year. And let's just be faithful in our giving. And we can't do it alone. Thankfully, God doesn't ask us to. He's given us a whole body of believers to work together with, and let's see what we can accomplish for him in the Great Commission in 2024. Amen? Amen? All right, let's pray. Father, thank you for bringing us back another night. Lord, thank you for another service we can come together on Resurrection Sunday and just spend some time reflecting on your death and burial and resurrection, and Lord, the implications in our own lives of that great event. Lord, I pray that you be glorified tonight through the singing and, Lord, through all that goes on, and we'll make sure we thank you and praise you for it. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
But somewhere along the way, we push the truth aside. False hope is being promised, but that's not why Jesus died. God wants the world to know that the blood still saves. God wants the world to see that the cross today with a Bible in their hand. The doctrine that they preach is based on shifting sand, but somehow we've missed the goal to show Christ to all mankind. We need to preach salvation. Lost souls are on the line. God wants the world to know that the blood still saves. God wants the world to see that the cross paved the way.
And the tomb where he was buried, well, that's now an empty grave.
So let's start sowing that God wants the world to know.
Let's stand together. We'll sing page 592, I Love to Tell the Story. Page 592. Brother Dowdy could not make it back this evening. He had a family get-together, and he told me he wasn't going to make it back in time, so he's not here. So the youth group will be staying upstairs. Brother Brian, are y'all staying up or going down? Staying up. All right, so Brother Young Adults will be going down. Brother Heath is taking them down. All right, so in just a few minutes when we shake hands with everybody, the young adults are kicked out of the auditorium. They'll have their class this evening. I thought you were saying we're staying right here, but you were saying we're going down. I got you. Page 592, I love to tell the story.
I love to tell the story of unseen things above. Of Jesus and His love. I love to tell the story because I know 'tis true. It satisfies my longings as nothing else can do. I love to tell the story. There'll be my theme in glory. Tell the old story of Jesus and His love.
All right, why don't y'all move around a little bit? Welcome somebody to church this evening. We'll come back and sing another verse or two in a minute, but tell someone you're happy to see them.
Together. I love to tell the story for those who know it best, seem hungering and thirsting to hear it like the rest. And when in scenes of glory I sing the new song, love so long. I love to tell the story. There'll be my theme in glory. To tell the old story of Jesus.
right, you may be seated. Ushers, come on with those offering plates. Mariah, come get everybody ready to sing. You kids, be careful with this cord up here. Don't trip and fall. We would hate to see that happen, but we would laugh at you. So just be real careful with that. As the ushers are coming, I'm not going to go over all the announcements that I went over this morning, but one correction I need to make it from the bulletin, as someone pointed out to me, that the bulletin says the ladies' prayer brunch is going to be on Sunday, April 27th, I think it said. It's not on Sunday. It's supposed to be on Saturday, and how we missed that, I'm not sure. So you probably already knew that, but I wanted to correct it before I forgot. All right, so where the bulletin says Sunday for the ladies' prayer brunch, it should say Saturday. If you have questions about that, see Brother Wireman. He will get you all straightened out. All right? What's that? Seniors Luncheon. Thank you. That's this Thursday. This Thursday at 11:30, Senior Citizens Luncheon. And so we want you to come out and be a part of that. Brother Dan and Miss Kelly, they're heading that up for us this month. And so come out and join us for that. They don't need to sign up or anything. Just show up. You have enough steaks for everybody? Okay, all right. By steaks, we mean bologna fried in a skillet. That's what we mean. All right, let's ask a blessing on the offering. Brother Tim, you've got the microphone. Why don't you go ahead and pray?
Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to be in church. Lord, we thank you for a free country, free people. We thank you for our salvation. We thank you for Resurrection Sunday. Lord, we love you. Take this offering. I pray it be used for thy glory. Amen.
Stay right there. Stay right there. Hold on, hold on, hold on, hold on. Come back up here real quick. She's done. I have that microphone. All right, so you said we got so much to thank him for, so I want to hear what you think about everything in your life and how good God's been to you. And I want you, we're going to talk into this microphone, and I want you to tell me what the thing is that you're most thankful for. All right, and you don't want to wait to go last because the rule is you can't say it if somebody else already has. All right, so who's got something you want to be thankful for this evening?
Thankful that he died on the cross to save our sins.
That's good. That's good. Dakota, are you thankful for something?
Yep.
What are you thankful for?
And thank you for he rose from the dead.
That's great. That's great. Iris, are you thankful for something? What are you thankful for?
Becca made
ate the things on for when he crucified on the play. Becca made ate the thing with sticks and pillow sheets
Nice.
For the play.
Great. Great. I would love to ask for more detail, but I'm also scared to ask for more detail.
I'm thankful for the Bible.
For the Bible? That's very good. Give it to Hudson right behind you. Oh, sorry, Luke.
I'm thankful for my family.
Your family? Oh, I'll give it to Luke. I skipped him on accident.
Thankful for my salvation.
Amen. Josiah?
Thankful for my house.
For your house?
Thankful for parents to guide me.
All right.
I'm thankful for a warm bed that I can sleep on.
Are you sleepy, Layla? She's getting ready for the preaching, probably. Mark, what are you thankful for?
I'm thankful for Jesus and that he died on the cross.
All right. Charlotte?
Thankful for a church.
For a church?
I'm thankful for that God always provides.
Amen. Sophia, you got anything? They took all your stuff, right? That's all right. You don't have to say anything. Well, if you don't say something, then you have to sing a special. I mean, it's you get to pick, so no, I'm just kidding. Very good. Abigail, you thankful for something? It's tough, isn't it? Who said you're thankful? Thankful for the church? Carson, you want to share something? No? All right. I said we go back to Dakota and Iris. They were the most entertaining. All right, find your seats real quick. Watch the cord. Please watch the cord. Watch the cord. All right. Thankful for the kids of the church. Really am. They can be a little noisy in the service sometimes, I suppose. But I've been in a church where there wasn't a kid in sight. And I'd rather put up with a little bit of noise in the church house and have these kids running around here and have a little bit of excitement and life in the church. It's just fine with me. And I'm really curious to find out what in the world Becca made for the play with sticks and pillows. I don't know what that's all about. All right. What do we want to do now? Let's see. Becca, I'm going to put you and Mom on the spot. I want y'all to sing that song you sang Wednesday night. If y'all come get ready to do that. I'd like to hear a couple of testimonies this evening. Listen, I want you to listen to what I'm saying. I want you to keep them short, okay? We want to keep them very concise with your thoughts. This is Resurrection Sunday. Certainly the resurrection has changed your life in some way from what it would have been otherwise. And I'd like to, maybe in just one or two short sentences, I don't mean Pauline epistle sentences, one or two sentences, just tell us this evening what you're thankful for. We'll pass the microphones around in just a minute so the folks at home can hear. But I would love to thank the Lord alongside of you for just a little bit this evening. So we'll spend 4 or 5 minutes doing that in just a moment. You guys go ahead and sing.
More than a story, more than a song. His love is gentle, yet it's so strong. His grace everlasting, just won't let you go. The Savior, let me introduce you, both now and forever. He's faithful and true. His name is Jesus. He died to give you life anew. Do you know the Savior? pardons the debtor when nothing to pay. He offers forgiveness to those gone astray. He stands there waiting at the door.
Music. I'm going to take a couple of testimonies this evening. I understand the microphones are already out there somewhere. I see a couple of guys in the back. So if you have a brief testimony, and again, let's try to keep it short this evening because we're still going to preach. So don't think because you keep talking that I'm going to stop talking. I'm going to just preach the same. All right. So kind of keep your thoughts concise. We'll start with Miss Whitaker right back here. Brother Heath. Anybody else? Miss Hess down front. Isaac right down front. Miss Ann. Who is that? Harrison? Right, we got Brother Piper. We'll start back here with Miss Whitaker. Make sure the light is green.
It is now.
Okay.
First of all, I can tell you what Iris was saying. Becca made the body that they carried in from the play, and she watched her, and I think she was amazed that it looked like real body.
Well, Becca's an expert at making corpse-like mannequins, so.
Yes, I am so thankful for my church. And for my home, my family, and my friends. And the church wouldn't be possible if the Lord hadn't risen from the dead.
Yeah.
And this whole Easter time is a time to think about what he's done for us in our salvation and just to really focus on it and nothing else. But I Amen. Appreciate it, and I love him.
Thank you, ma'am. Brother Piper.
No, a lot of times I'm not the brightest bulb on the tree. But I'm so thankful that 39 years ago, actually 40 years ago, I went to an old Baptist country church, a city church, but it was a Baptist church, and I heard the clear presentation of the gospel, and I just could not hardly believe that God would love me enough to forgive me. And I'm just so thankful that he made it simple enough for me that I could be saved.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Piper. Ms. Hess?
After the play, or during the play, whatever, I've seen that one before. It still always gets me. And I leaned over and I asked James, why is the sound of those nails both horrifying and joyful? And then I watched one of the Easter movies with some friends, and seeing the nail prints in his hands, it's like he could have erased those scars, but him leaving his scars prove what he did. And so it's just like, it's hope that we're not going to have any scars
sure.
when we get to heaven.
Sure. Amen. All right. Anybody else have the microphone right now or would like the microphone? Raise your hand. We'll get it to you real quick. Miss Heather's got her hand up over here. Brother Heath. And come right down here. These two ladies want the microphone. Anybody right here? Miss anybody? Miss Drake, Miss Prater both want it. Where are you going, Isaac? Oh, I thought you were giving the mic to somebody. All right, right down here, Ms. Prater, Ms. Drake, want it? Heather, go ahead.
I'm thankful for unanswered prayers. There's been a lot of prayers I've prayed for years that have gone unanswered. However, because of that, God has made me astutely aware of other things that I need to be extremely thankful for. And so I'm thankful that he did not answer a prayer, but he showed me
sure.
other ways that he had blessed me.
Amen.
So.
Amen. That's good. Why don't you pass it right down to Miss Teresa? I think she had her hand up. Ms. Teresa?
I thank God I'm redeemed.
Yeah.
And I thank God for our family, the church family.
Amen.
And the children.
Yeah.
We serve an amazing God.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Ms. Drake?
I'm so thankful that the Lord is always with me. He never leaves me, never forsakes me. He's always right with me every minute of every day, and I just praise him and thank him for that.
Amen. Amen. Ms. Prater?
I am very thankful for God's protection. He's been there for me, and for my brother fell and hurt himself very bad. And I prayed real hard for him, and God always comes through.
Amen. Amen.
And I just thank him for it.
Amen. Oh, thank you, Ms. Prater. We've got... we've got some very precious ladies. Just pass right on down. Harrison, grab that microphone, please, sir. Going back there. Okay. Just a second, Ms. Shinnerberry. We've got some very precious older ladies in our church and very, very faithful. We used to call them the 80s ladies, but most of them are in their 90s now. And Ms. Prater and Ms. Drake sit right there and so faithful to be at church if they're able to be here. I'm thinking of Ms. Helen Hancock. She would be here if she was not in a care home right now. She would be right here, I guarantee it. Ms. Jan Moore. Ms. Jan got saved very late in life, and about 12, maybe 13 years ago. And she never missed a service until she got ill. And she'd be right here if she wasn't in a care home in Chelsea. We're so thankful for the testimony and the example of some of these ladies. Ms. Shinnerberry.
I'm just thankful for God's blessings through our years, and I'm thankful for his provision for us, the peace that he gives, and his presence in our lives.
Amen. Amen. Melody, why don't you come get ready to sing that song? I feel bad. I told Melody, someone asked her to sing this particular song, and she said, well, I just sang that a couple of weeks ago. I said, oh, yeah, you're right. And then I just had my family sing a song they sang Wednesday, so I feel bad. Brother Stephen, you get your way. That's what I'm trying to say. Brother Steve, you got the microphone. Go right ahead.
I'm thankful for God's grace, and so this morning it's just a reminder of what God's grace has brought me from. Bradley had commented on his new job that he has, and he's like, "Oh, I work with somebody that knew you, and they knew me from when I was a teenager," and I said, "Ooh," and he's like, "Yeah." She made quite the face when I said you were my assistant pastor. And I'm just so thankful. I don't deserve to be where I am, and it's only because of his grace that I'm here. I'm thankful for him.
Amen. I saw one more over here. Brother Brian, you got your hand up. Why don't you stand up? You'll be the last one this evening.
I'm thankful for the certainty of the resurrection. This morning you preached on the problems that arise when you don't recognize that Christ rose from the grave, and I'm so thankful. I was reading this morning how the two men on the road to Emmaus, after they had been with Jesus, they said, "He has risen indeed." And we can, as we tell our children and sit down with them and explain to them how Christ died for our sins and rose from the grave, there's no doubt in my mind, there's no question that Christ is risen.
Amen.
And I'm thankful for that.
Amen. Thank you, Brian.
And the lion now. Jesus prayed, if it be thy will, let this cup pass from me.
Let's stand together, please. Take your Bibles, find the Gospel of Mark. Thank you for all of the special music, and some of those were requests from people. It seems like we don't have choir, and we have a little extra time. I don't mind trying to get to some of the requests, and so we're glad to do that this evening. Thank you for all the special music. Let's find the Gospel of Mark in chapter 9. Mark chapter 9. We'll read a verse or two, and then you can be seated after we pray. Mark chapter 9. Let's begin reading. Let's start at the beginning of the chapter. In Mark chapter 9, verse 1 says, "And he said unto them, Verily I say unto you, that there be some of them that stand here which shall not taste of death, till they have seen the kingdom of God come with power. And after 6 days Jesus taketh with him Peter and James and John, and leadeth them up into a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his raiment became shining, exceeding white as snow, so as no fuller on earth can white them. And there appeared unto them Elias with Moses, and they were talking with Jesus. And Peter," can we just stop and just acknowledge how casually Scripture reads about this event? It's the amazing impact of what we just read, and it summarizes it in about four verses and says, yeah, there was Elias and Moses, and they were talking with Jesus, and then just moves on as though our minds are not about to explode trying to comprehend what is going on. Absolutely amazing. Verse 5, "And Peter answered and said to Jesus, Master," good old Peter, "Master, it's good for us to be here. And let us make 3 tabernacles, one for thee, and one for Moses, and one for Elias. For he wist not what to say. for they were sore afraid. And there was a cloud that overshadowed them, and a voice came out of the cloud saying, "This is my beloved Son, hear him." And suddenly, when they had looked round about, they saw no man any more, save Jesus only with themselves. And as they came down from the mountain, he charged them that they should tell no man what things they had seen, till the Son of Man were risen from the dead. And they kept that saying with themselves, questioning one with another what the rising from the dead should mean. Father, would you bless your word? God, give us wisdom with it this evening. Please speak to our hearts. Well, thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. I think sometimes we're awful hard on certain characters in Scripture. We have the luxury of standing back 2,000 years after the fact and reading it and having time in a very controlled setting to read about the events in detail and see things, kind of the aerial view of everything. And then many times we sit back and say, they ought to be ashamed for the way they behaved. I don't think that's fair. Come on, think about Peter that night on the stormy sea. Peter, whether he put his foot in his mouth or not, we can debate that some other time, but the fact remains that Peter got out of the boat and began to walk on the water to Jesus. Yes, he failed and sank, but he got out of the boat and walked on the water. I think that's pretty notable. I think instead of coming down hard on Peter, I think we ought to just sit back and say, way to go, Peter. I mean, the man had some issues, there's no doubt. But in that particular case, I think it's pretty impressive. Now, we find other situations as well where we sit back and say, how could they not have known? How could they have doubted? Well, if we were there and not in a comfortable little church where we get to read about it and criticize it from our little point of view, but to be right in the middle of it. And it's that idea that really makes certain situations like the fiery furnace that much more impressive, because in the middle of that chaotic, violent, dangerous scene, those Hebrew children still had the wherewithal and integrity to stand up to the king. Just amazing things. And so in this passage, at the beginning of the passage, in this chapter 9, we read about Jesus stealing away with Peter and just a couple of disciples, and they go up into the mountain, and Jesus, knowing full well what was about to happen, and I wish the scripture gave us more detail about the setting and the whole purpose of the Mount of Transfiguration. Listen, I've got commentaries in my office, I've got numbers more on my computer, and you begin to read about what some of these Bible commentators say about the Mount of Transfiguration. And it's obvious that they're trying to fill up a page with words, but they really have no idea what to even make of it. Think about how strange this is. It's one thing when Jesus in Matthew chapter 3 goes into the River Jordan and begins to draw the attention. John the Baptist sees him coming and says, "Behold, the Lamb of God." And he comes into the river, and there's John the Baptist. And John says, "Lord, I have need to be baptized of you, and yet you're here to be baptized of me." Jesus said, "Just suffer it to be so. Let it be so." So John says, "Yes, sir," begins to baptize Jesus, and the voice from heaven speaks again, "Lo, this is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased." That's amazing. And we can almost, in our human minds, I can come up with some good reasons why that needed to be, or why that was that way. Baptism, if it was going to be a prerequisite for even into the church age of believers' baptism, you know, membership into the church, all of that, I could say, yeah, I could see why Jesus needed to be baptized. I could see a useful purpose of it when that big crowd saw Jesus in the water and they heard a voice from heaven say, "This is my beloved Son." I'd say it solidified in those people's minds that this was the Son of God. I could find some purposes to it, but the Mount of Transfiguration is just strange to me. Here's Jesus, not publicly in front of everybody, but by himself, just with two or three disciples up in the top of a mountain. A cloud overshadows them. There's Elijah and Moses sitting there talking with Jesus. I would have loved to have known what the conversation was about. The Bible doesn't tell us. Why not? I don't know. And this is my beloved Son. He says it again. I don't understand the scene. I'm just saying it was a pretty amazing scene. I don't know the purpose behind it, but I believe it happened just the way the Bible says it happened. And here's what we want to look at this evening. After all of that, poor Peter, the passage flat out says they didn't know what to say. So Peter does what Peter does. It speaks up. It says, "Lord, it's good that we were here." I don't know what he means. See, telling the Lord you're really blessed that we were here to be onlookers. I don't know. Is it Peter saying it was good for me personally to be here? I don't know. All I know is Peter, pastor says they were sore afraid, didn't know what to say. So Peter says, it's good that we were here. Let's build some tabernacles because obviously Elijah and Moses have nowhere to sleep tonight. Let's give them a place. I don't know. But on the way down, Jesus says, I don't want you to tell anybody what you've seen until I've risen from the dead. And I suppose if someone told me that, in my mind, that would be a pretty significant statement. But in this passage, it's not enough to really even provoke long conversation about it. It says that they kept it in their heart. But then when you compare that statement to what they've just seen, I guess maybe it wasn't such a big statement. But it says they were reasoning in themselves what the raising from the dead should mean. Now, I think if we're going to be honest with Scripture, then we would say that at that point they did not realize Jesus Christ was going to be crucified. I don't think they, at this point in Jesus' ministry, I don't think they saw that coming. And so if they didn't see that coming, they probably did not see the resurrection from the dead coming. And so when they reasoned and questioned within themselves what this should mean, they were probably trying to figure out who's rising from the dead, who's dying, and all of that. And here we are 2,000 years later looking back, and we know very well what death Jesus was speaking of. We know very well what the rising from the dead meant and what rising of the dead he was speaking about. But here we are 2,000 years later, I also think there are a lot of well-meaning Christians who, understanding that it was Jesus who would be killed and risen from the dead, are still asking themselves, what is it all about? I found myself very aggravated one time. I was talking to somebody. There was two or three of us standing around in a group, and we were talking about our beliefs and certain things in the Bible, some hard things in the Bible. And it was obvious that one of these guys that we were having this conversation with really had a hard time believing, and or maybe not believing, but convincing others that Jesus did, in fact, raise from the dead, or that he did, in fact, rise from the tomb. And he made a statement, not a quote, but the statement was something along the lines of, well, it's okay, we can disagree on certain things as long as we acknowledge that Jesus was the Son of God. Now listen, there are some minor things that you and I can disagree with and love one another and just, I hate the saying, but we'll say it, agree to disagree. But there are some things that are not negotiable. There are some things that there is no room for compromise, and the resurrection from the dead is one of those. It's not one of those things that we can say, well, we don't all have to believe it. What really matters is we believe in God. That is not acceptable. The resurrection is so vitally important to everything that we are in Christ Jesus. Ms. Whitaker said a while ago she thanks the Lord for the church, and she connected it to the resurrection of Jesus Christ, because had he not risen from the dead, then none of this would be possible. It is that vital to all that we are in Christ Jesus. So let's spend just a few minutes this evening trying to answer that question that these disciples asked within themselves. That verse 10, we'll read it again. It says, and they kept that saying with themselves, questioning one another what the rising from the dead should mean. So let's answer it in our own way, in our 2024 American Christian minds. Let's try to answer, what in the world does it mean? Why is it so important? Why is it something that we cannot compromise on? Let me give you a few reasons very, very quickly what the rising from the dead should mean. Number one, it is the proof that Jesus is God. Jesus is God. I don't mean that Jesus was God. I mean that Jesus is, in the present tense, God. See, the Bible says that we have a mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. It also goes on to say that he is sitting, he's ever making intercession for us at the right hand of God. Right now, while we're on this earth in this little church house studying about the resurrected Lord is sitting at the right hand of God right now, the man Christ Jesus making intercession for us. Praise his name. The resurrection proves that Jesus was, in fact, God. Find Matthew chapter 20, if you would please. Matthew chapter 20. Says in Matthew chapter 20, verse 17, and Jesus, going up to Jerusalem, took the 12 disciples apart in the way and said unto them, behold, we go up to Jerusalem. The Son of Man shall be betrayed into the chief priests and unto the scribes, and they shall condemn him to death and shall deliver him to the Gentiles to mock, to scourge, and to crucify him. And the third day he shall rise again. Those who say that Jesus never expressly claimed to rise from the dead ahead of time don't know their Bible. He didn't just say that he was going to be killed and that he was going to rise from the dead. He said, I'm going to be scourged, I'm going to be mocked, I'm going to be killed, but don't worry, 3 days later, I'm going to rise. He claims it right here before his death. And so therefore, if he does not make good on that, he's a liar. And if he's a liar, he cannot be God. God is not a liar. God is holy in every way. And so therefore, if Jesus makes this claim and does not rise from the dead, I will go on further than that. Had Jesus made this claim and died some other way, he would not be God. Jesus said, I'm going to Jerusalem, and when we get there, I'm going to be delivered unto these wicked men who are going to scourge me and mock me and kill me. And in 3 days, I'm going to rise again. That's a bold claim. That's a claim that only God in the flesh could make good on. And he did, because Jesus is God. Find the Gospel of John, chapter 1. I have us turn there this evening, not because I doubt you know this passage. If you've been in our church very long, then you've certainly heard this passage quoted and read. I love these verses. There are some who claim that we don't find the deity of Jesus in our Bible. I say look no further than the first few verses of John chapter 1. The Gospel of John chapter 1 says very, very simply, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. We find later on over the book of Revelation, Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, is called the Word. And I want you to know that Jesus is God. Nothing has changed, and the resurrection proves that he is God. Don't let anyone convince you that the resurrection of Jesus Christ is not important. Everything we believe is built upon not just his death on the cross. His death on the cross is meaningless if he never raises from the dead. The resurrection of Jesus Christ is the foundation on which our faith is built. What the rising of the dead should mean. So number one, it means that Jesus is God. Number two, the resurrection from the dead proves that sin has been paid for. Sin has been paid for. We could go read Isaiah 53, and we could read about the suffering of Jesus, and one thing that comes up over and over and over again in that chapter of Isaiah is that it was our suffering that he took. It was our iniquity that he bore. It was our affliction that he made his own. It was ours. He took on him the sin of the world. That's us, our sin placed on him. If Jesus was the bearer of our sin, that means our sin had to be paid for. For Jesus Christ to rise from the dead, having not paid for my sin, would mean that he did not accomplish that which he set out to do, and he could not have risen from the dead. But the fact that he did means my justification is complete. Sin has been paid for. What does the rising from the dead mean? It means that I am no longer condemned by my sin. I'm so glad that I have an empty tomb that I point to. Look at Romans chapter 5, verse 12. You know this verse very well. Romans 5, verse 12 says, wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. These are verses in what we commonly call the Romans Road. Chapter 6, verse 23 says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." The wages of sin is death. That's what I had earned. It's what I deserved. I was not forced under that. And my sinful flesh craved it. I had it coming. Jesus Christ stepped in on my behalf in obedience to his Father and paid for my sin. He received the wages that I had earned. Jesus Christ took them. And by rising from the dead, proved that my sin had been taken care of. It's taken out of the way. Romans chapter 4, verse 25 says, "Who was delivered for our offenses and was raised again for our justification." I believe it was Adrian Rogers. I wish I had written this quote down. I believe it was Adrian Rogers said, that the empty tomb is our eternal sales receipt that says paid in full. I like that. The resurrection from the dead means, first of all, that Jesus is God. Second of all, that sin has been paid for. Thirdly, the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead means that God's justice has been satisfied. God's justice has been satisfied. A Puritan preacher several centuries ago, preached a sermon. Jonathan Edwards was his name, preached the sermon, "Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God." And if you've never read that sermon, you can find it. You can easily find the transcript of it online, I'm sure. I've probably got a copy of it in my office. I have lots of Jonathan Edwards sermons. And in that sermon, he outlines and traces through Scripture the justice of God, the fiery indignation of God. He so adequately points out that our God is a consuming fire. He's a God who cannot ignore and turn a blind eye to sin and iniquity. He would not be a holy and a just God if he simply brushed it under the rug. God's justice must be satisfied. The empty tomb is evidence that it has been satisfied. Find 1 Corinthians chapter 15 with me, if you would, please. 1 Corinthians 15, as you're finding 1 Corinthians 15, let me read to you a verse from Galatians. We've been studying the book of Galatians together, and so we've already read this verse, and you may be familiar with it. You find 1 Corinthians 15, Galatians chapter 1:4, listen to what it says, "Who gave himself for our sins, that he might deliver us from this evil world according to the will of God, our Father." We find that Jesus Christ was delivered up for our sins. He did it that he might deliver us from this present evil world according to the will of God, our Father. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, I love this passage. Let's begin reading in verse 55. Oh, verse 54. No, let's pick up 52. "In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trump shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed." Hey, if you don't believe in the resurrection of the dead of Jesus Christ, man, you better buckle up, because there's coming a day there's going to be a whole lot more than one person rising from the dead. If you don't believe me, read this passage. Read 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. We're just waiting on the trump of God to sound, folks. It could happen tonight, and frankly, it'd be just fine with me if it does. I can't think of a better way to go home to glory than in the middle of preaching about the cross of Jesus Christ and the resurrection from the dead. That'd be all right with me. Look what it says, verse 52, "In the moment, in twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trump shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality, I don't think so. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ." Hey, folks, Jesus Christ accomplished something through his death, burial, and resurrection that the only way we would ever accomplish it is by paying for our sins with eternity in hell. God's justice was satisfied through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. The empty tomb is proof of that. The resurrection is so vitally important. If he didn't raised from the dead, then God's justice is still unsatisfied and will demand something from sinners. But if God the Father looked at the payment of Jesus Christ and said, yeah, that's good enough, then we would expect to find an empty tomb where Jesus was resurrected back to life. He resurrected for our justification, the Bible says. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 12, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. You know what we read about in that verse? Let's just spend a couple of minutes looking at this. Go ahead and find the book of Hebrews chapter 9. Find Hebrews chapter 9 and then find John chapter 14. Hebrews chapter 9 and the Gospel of John chapter 14. We are told in the book of Hebrews chapter 8, 9, and 10, we are told that those parts of the Old Testament, the law, the Old Testament covenant, they served a bigger purpose, an eternal purpose. They served the purpose of representing and being a foreshadowing of, as the Bible says, of good things to come. By this we mean that the wilderness tabernacle, the layout of the wilderness tabernacle is modeled after something. If you read the book of Exodus and into the book of Leviticus, and you look at the layout, I'm talking about the physical footprint of the wilderness tabernacle and the tent tabernacle. If you look at that and you couple that with the laws and the ordinances for the Levites and priests outlined in the book of Leviticus, you sit back and you say, what a strange thing. So odd, those dimensions and those layouts. Think about it. Picture some 110-foot-long rectangle of a wall. And it's not a wall of wood and or timber of some sort. It's not a wall of brick. It's a wall of cloth, of hanging. There's post every few feet, and this linen, this woven curtain would hang all the way around. This is what made up the courtyard, is what we call it, refer to it as, of the tabernacle. At one end of this courtyard, there was another hanging that served as the gate, and they could pull these hangings, this curtain back, and that's how the Levites and priests would enter in and go out of the courtyard or the tabernacle complex, if you want to think of it that way. That's where they would receive the sacrifices from the people, is through that gate. But then as you move in, if you were to come through that curtain, the first thing you would see is this elevated altar, this place that was always smoking and on fire. It's where they would offer the burnt sacrifice. And if you were to walk up to that and then go around behind it so where it's at your back, you would then notice this peculiar-looking structure. Now, the wilderness tabernacle, as opposed to the Temple of Solomon, it was a tent-like structure, but the sides of this tent were made of gold overlaid boards that were about 15 feet high. It was 15 feet wide and 15 feet high, and it was this oblong rectangle cube, if you want to think of it that way. And there was over this was all these kinds of skins and woven fabrics. It's so strange. And at the very front of the actual tabernacle structure, underneath all those coverings, you'd find these pillars with another curtain dividing it. And if you were to pull the curtain back and go in, you'd come to the what we call the outer chamber or the holy place. And immediately in front of you, you'd see a small golden altar of incense. And to your right, you'd see the table of showbread, a small golden table with little various dishes and things on it. To your left, you'd find the candlestick. You know, the menorah is modeled after this candlestick. It's got all these different branches and knops and leaves. All you know the description in the scriptures. Just behind that golden altar of incense, though, another row of pillars. Another very heavy veil. Behind that veil is what's called the Holy of Holies, or the Most Holy Place. And if you were to walk up and begin to try to pull that veil back, it's a very dark room. There's no light in there. But as the light from the candlestick would reflect off those gold overlaid walls, no doubt there would be some reflection in there. You would see the Ark of the Covenant. Now, here's why I tell you all of that. The Bible says that all of that was modeled after something. It was not just a strange and peculiar design. It was God saying, I know what the real is like. Let me tell you, I want you to make a model for me. Now, if you were to read the book of Ezekiel and even parts of Daniel and you get into Isaiah and Jeremiah, you're going to find descriptions of the throne room of God. If you go to Revelation chapter 4, 5, and 6, you're going to find another description of the throne room of God. You find it is so similar to that tabernacle of the Old Testament. Now, why are we going through all of this? You're in Hebrews chapter 9. Read this verse with me again. It tells us what Jesus Christ did with his blood. Look at what it says in Hebrews chapter 9 and verse, well, let's read verses 11 and 12. But Christ, being come and high priest of good things to come, by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood, he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. This holy place that the Bible says Jesus entered into, it was not some golden rectangle covered over by badger skins and goat skins. It was not some temple that we call Solomon's temple, as beautiful as it was. It says it was not made with hands. Where Jesus had to enter into was something far greater than that. Now go to John chapter 14. Let's put this together. That holy place, that most holy, once a year the high priest would enter into that, but the Bible says he would enter in, but not without blood. He would take the blood of that perfect spotless lamb, and he would peel that curtain back and sprinkle the blood in on the holy, the mercy seat on that ark. He didn't dare, as a sinful man, step into that place without having offered the blood of a perfect spotless lamb. Some of you are already making the connections. Hebrews 9, we just read it, says that Jesus Christ went into a holy place not made with hands, that is, not of this building, the Bible says, something far greater. And it was not with the blood of some lamb or goat or bull or calf, but with his own blood. He entered in one time, not year by year, one time. And he obtained eternal redemption for us. We read the passage we're about to read. We read it at funerals because it gives us hope. But I want you to know that what we're about to read is not just a passage about how great heaven's going to be. It's a passage that tells us what Jesus Christ did with his own blood. Verse 1, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, period. Does your Bible have a period right there? Amen. Jesus is saying, while he spoke these words, already in existence in heaven was a place for us to live and dwell. There were already mansions there. But he says, I'm going to serve a bigger purpose than just building you a cabin next door to Jesus. So much bigger. You know what he did? Look what it says next. I go to prepare a place for you. You know what that great high priest did once a year as he pulled that veil back on that tabernacle and presented the blood of that lamb? You know what he was doing? He was preparing a place for him to step into the presence of God. That's why the Bible says he dared not do it without blood. That's what your Bible says. I go to prepare a place for you. You know what Jesus Christ did for you and me? Jesus Christ took his own blood and entered into the throne room of God. And in the very presence of Almighty God, he presented his blood for us. And in doing so, prepared a place for us to stand in the presence of God. Now that's so much better than just using that passage to say, one day I'll see my loved ones again. This passage tells me that one day I'll stand in the presence of God, not a condemned sinner, but in a place that Jesus Christ prepared for me with his own blood. He purchased my eternal redemption. You're going to tell me the resurrection of the dead is not important? It all, everything we believe is built upon the fact of the resurrection. If Jesus Christ didn't rise from the dead, then he never prepared a place for me. If Jesus Christ didn't rise from the dead, then God's justice is not satisfied and his wrath is still kindled and burning hot towards me. If Jesus Christ didn't rise from the dead, then all those claims he made are false and he couldn't possibly be God. But if he did rise from the dead, then he is the Son of God. If he did rise from the dead, then God's justice is satisfied. And if he did rise from the dead, then right now, there's a place prepared for me in the presence of God. I believe in the resurrection. It's not a take it or leave it doctrine for me. And it ought not be for you either. A lot is hinging on the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. I don't know how much news you read, but this last week our president made a blasphemous mockery of today. Presidential decree labeling today some trans recognition day. This world has no appreciation for the resurrection of the dead, because they don't know him like I know him. They don't understand how significant that moment in history was when Jesus Christ with his own blood stood before his Father and said, "This is for Adam Summers. Just want to let you know that I've paid for his sins." And God says, "I'm satisfied." They don't understand it, but we do. You plant your feet firmly on the doctrine of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Without it, we have nothing. We have nothing. Let's stand together, please. There are many other things that I had in my notes that we could have gone over this evening, but I think this is a good stopping place. Aren't you thankful for your salvation? Amen. Hey, listen, we have so often dumbed salvation down to just a real quick repeat after me. It's so much bigger than that. It's the eternal plan of God. Jesus was the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. I'm so thankful he's offered us salvation through him. Lord, thank you for your word. God, thank you for sending Jesus. Thank you for the precious blood that was shed for us. Lord, I thank you for the resurrection. Lord, I pray that you would take the words spoken this evening. God, please stir our hearts up. Lord, please renew our appreciation and value that we have for Resurrection Day. And Lord, I pray for those that are here and those that are watching at home this evening. Lord, you know the needs spiritually and physically. Lord, I ask that you would intervene and work in their lives like only you can. Lord, it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Brother Luke, what do you have picked out this evening?
515.
Page 515. The altar's open this evening. We'll sing a verse or two. Page 515. You come as the Lord leads. Let's sing it together on the first verse, page 515.
Those from
river.
Let's sing that second verse together, and then on the chorus, just lift your voices. Let's do it a cappella when we get to the chorus. I know it's an invitation, but let's not sing it like it's an invitation. Let's sing it like it's a going home anthem. Sing it from your heart. We'll do it a cappella on the chorus. All right, all together on the second. Brother Dan Gill, would you come this way? I want you to close us in prayer this evening. Thank you so much for being here. We've got some guests with us, and we're glad that they are here, but we need to pray for them because they are members of the church, my brother-in-law pastors. And so a lot there to pray about. I'm just kidding. I love Daniel. He's been a pastor there for a couple of years now, I guess, maybe 2 or 3 years, really doing a great job out in Romulus, Hope Baptist in Romulus. Thank you all for being here today. I sure do appreciate it. You have an open invitation. With your pastor's blessing, you have an open invitation. And they don't have church this evening. That's why they're here. Otherwise, they'd be there. All right. Please plan to come back on Wednesday. Don't forget about Seniors Luncheon on Thursday at 11:30. And the Lord willing, we'll see you for all of that. Brother Gill, you dismiss us in prayer, please, sir.
All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the great day we've had in your house. Lord, thank you for the day that we celebrate today, your resurrection. And Lord, as we learn this evening, everything that it means, we just thank you so much for it. Lord, help us to live this coming week with that thought in mind. And Lord, may we be a testimony to those that we're around. And Lord, I pray that you would give us opportunities to share you with others throughout the week as well. Please watch over us as we travel home now. Please bring us back safely on Wednesday evening. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.